They were five. They were at least five songs in. I'm like, okay.
Oh, you were all worshipped out.
People standing, so I think I've done my Jesus. So.
Hey, everybody. Well, hey, everybody. Welcome to Rose Bibles and Beer. This is Jeff. It's episode 222. I was surprised. Andy, how's it going?
Homies.
Pretty
Zach?
Good.
Zack?
Never gets old.
Woo!
And Jeff, how are you?
I'm high on Jesus.
All right. Excellent.
All right, boys. I got you good on that one.
I was headphoneless.
Dude, I thought maybe I'll hide the listener. Ooh. There's like a time clock that's going on the side here. I was like, maybe I'll turn that off so that Jeff can't tell that it's actually recording.
Least observant person on the planet right here.
And for the record, it's not cooked.
No.
He's surprised every time, and often I'm surprised too. Andy's got a subtle way about him. So well done. Genuinely surprised every time.
Like Billy Joel said.
You almost had
got a way about me.
You almost had to play pinch hitter there, Zack.
I did. I was going to, but then I encouraged you. All right. Well,
time to pour some beers, boys.
All right, boys.
Hey, boys, get those beers out, eh?
Pitter patter. Let's get at her.
Okay.
Oh. Got a frothy head on this beer. Poured it like a chump. Though, according to our friend...
That's aggressive. Oh.
Yeah, that's right. Go ahead, Andy.
Yeah, according to our friend who runs a tap room, that's what you're supposed to do is just dump it in and let it foam to hell. I'm like, wait, what? Why? Because then it's less filling, right?
He's the bottom line. You burp less, and apparently, there you go. What's the difference between...
You've got Coca-Cola?
Cheers. Yeah, cheers.
And we have urine samples.
You have the darkest.
You should drink more water. This is a Radiant Beer Company.
It's called Renal Failure.
Renal Failure Black IPA. It's called Jeff Runs a Marathon Without Training.
Second, I really dies.
Renal Failure. That's kind of what it looks like.
That's not it's kind of crass, but not a terrible name if you're desperate for a name. A Light in the Dark Black IPA. And Black IPA, also formerly known as Scandinavian IPAs, I believe, because of all that black metal up there.
Oh, that's why.
I've got one of my faves.
Hold on.
Oh, sorry.
I'm not done.
I repent.
They use some nice dark and toasted malts in addition to aggressively hopping, and it's kind of a unique flavor. You get some roastedness
to go with
the hops.
Jeff is stealing it. Now he's sniffing it. Now he's drinking it.
And now I have COVID.
And he's making a face like it didn't go
down.
Yeah,
it's not for everyone.
It's good.
Do you remember Stone Brewing Company had Sublimely Self-Righteous back in the day? That was pretty good.
I thought you were going to say, do you remember Stone Brewing Company?
They're still around, although their heyday has passed. But they had Sublimely Self-Righteous Black IPA. Delicious. It had a moment, kind of like hazy IPAs are having their moment.
Black Eyed Peas A.
Mm-hmm.
Comedy.
Comedy jokes. All right, and you gentlemen.
Who brought this?
I did.
Zack brought that.
Oh,
Beechwood.
I love Beechwood. Andy, you have the same thing, right?
Yeah, Cosmic Lottery is the one that we're having. But, you know, we've said it so many times. Can't go wrong with Beechwood.
No, not at all.
Beechwood.
And there's always that hint. There's always that hint of any Beechwood beer that you have that you're like, immediately you know, oh, this is a Beechwood. And it's called goodness. That's what the hint is. It's a hint of goodness.
It's fantastic. Well,
thanks for supplying the beers tonight, Zack.
Yeah, excellent. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. You guys will get me later.
That's aggressive. That feels aggressive.
This is aggressive, and it might not stand.
Not only that, but like, just put it down here, man.
This aggression shall not stand. I was going to give you access to the buttons, but...
I do have access to the buttons. More access, in fact, here.
Okay.
Sorry.
So you guys... from last week to this week, and how are things?
I'm all better, guys.
Fantastic. That's the way it works.
I want you to know, listener and viewer, that through prayer, Andy is fixed.
I got fixed. Meaning I had a vasectomy over the week and am now fixed. No, I had that done a long time
ago. We laid hands on it and everything. It was just a really spiritual experience.
Oh my gosh. I had a spiritual vasectomy.
Okay.
What does that mean now? My prayers don't count.
Oh, a spiritual vasectomy?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
So on a scale of 1 to 10.
Show title.
How are you?
No bullshit, sit rep.
Well, I would have been a higher point total had I not just had a little bomb dropped at the end of my day. So,
your work day?
Yeah, at the end of my work day. So, but in general, I'm hovering between the 5 to 7 range is what I'll say. Out of 10.
That is a wide, that's a wide range.
Five I know. To seven. Welcome to my world, man.
That's average to above average.
No.
Average remember, to average plus.
If we're going for score, if we're going for grades, I got an F, 50.
50, 50 F is to an a F. C.
Well, Zack always saw that
I didn't
as
graduate
average.
High school. I didn't graduate high school with my peers, so
I
what do
you,
I know?
I don't know how to read.
Well, and I'm doing fantastic. How about you, Jeff?
I'm great.
Oh, that's all cool. Right. Describe it to me. Tell me what it's like.
Well, okay. I'm about to go on vacation. Public school teacher here in California. And in a couple of days,
I'm sorry, parents.
Off for 3 weeks. And I actually love going to work, honestly. Now taking a vacation, going to see my dad. I'm excited and,
up in Idaho.
Yeah. Yeah. Up in Idaho next to Canada.
Yeah. It's next to Canada.
over by Minnesota.
Minnesota in Idaho.
You know, you're just separated by Montana and, Wyoming and the Dakotas.
North of California.
Say hi to America's hat for us.
Yeah.
I will do that.
Are we Canada's pants?
We might be. If they're the hat, maybe we're Canada's deep V. And now, Mexico is our pants.
I guess we're the giant head.
Yeah, if they're the hat, we're the giant head. Yeah, and we cry ourselves to sleep on our huge pillow. Yeah,
going sideways.
The neck of Mexico down to the ample bosom of Brazil.
They're known more for butts, but I'll take a bosom.
Maybe they'll be the butt too.
So speaking of butts.
Yeah.
At work all week, I had a group of girls said, Mr. Pearson, do you have any cake? Got cake? Do you have any cake? I'm like,
what is this new code?
Exactly. I'm like,
this is sus, Jeff.
So by the second day, I'm reaching in my pocket like, well, let me check and kind of playing along. And then I went home yesterday and I'm at the dinner table. I told my wife, hey, these kids just keep asking me if I have cake.
Did you Google it with safe search off?
Okay. Well, my youngest daughter, freshman in high school, she's like, wait, what did they say? I'm like, here we go.
Uh-oh.
And they said, do you have cake? And
she's like, I'll tell you the answer, but first give me 20 bucks.
She said, were they laughing when they were saying it? And I'm like, yes, they have been. But I don't know if they're just think it's funny. And I go, is there another meaning? And she says, yes. I said, what is that? And she said, well, it's butt. Like somebody who has, you got cake, like you have a full butt.
Big booty.
So I don't know if it's true, but my wife and I were talking about this last night during this conversation, and she's like, you should bring cake. Just.
Oh, to tonight?
So today at work, the students come up to me and I'm prepared.
I was looking forward
to
it.
And they're like, do you have cake, Mr.? And I'm like, follow me. And they followed me and they were
into
like,
the bathroom.
Oh my gosh. They're like, oh my gosh.
Oh my
gosh. I had little lemon cakes for all of them. It was a great moment. And then as they're walking,
you could have somehow hit him in your back pocket. Yeah, I do. Wait,
as they're taking their cake and walking out of my classroom, I said, oh, by the way, any chance it means something else? And they went, no, it doesn't mean that. And I went, wait, I didn't refer to a that. So
what do you mean by that?
Any
snared him.
Any chance it means but? And then I heard one little girl go, okay, let's go.
And you're like, I'm going to need that cake back here.
Anyway.
On my desk.
You better believe I got that cake. So they're walking out. All right. How about this?
What does it mean to blow out the candles?
This is great. We didn't put somebody on the 9-month waiting list to hear their feedback.
Give me a slice of that cake.
All right.
I'm going to kick you in the cake.
All right. This is from our old friend. And I mean old in the sense that he's really old.
Sorry, Art.
He's my best, oldest friend.
Yes.
In the universe. Multiple time guest. Welcome back anytime when he's not golfing in the beautiful Rancho Mirage vicinity.
Oh, I was right.
Art Greco.
Ba-da-ba-ba-ba.
An Otani shout out to you.
Yeah.
The Art Deco of silver-haired foxes, Art Greco. He sent us an email. He's bundling 220 and 221 with these comments, putting my thoughts in bullet points for the sake of brevity.
Nice.
For Bro Jeff, I know you already know this, but your comments about mystery, quote unquote, you seem to struggle with it just a little bit. Remind me of this. Mystery is not the opposite of faith. It's the precursor of it.
Ooh.
Now it's not faith unless it's a conviction, belief held in the context of mystery or something that's not yet provable. Reconstructing is not faithlessness. It's thoughtfulness. And he put that in all caps.
Yeah, I like that.
For my excellent bro, Andy, thanks for allowing us all to walk with you through what Zack was reluctant to call he keeps saying reconstruction. I use the word deconstruction. And having had enough conversations with him, I think he likes, to him, there's like, and I tend to agree, you're never actually, you might in the temporary be tearing something down, but it's something always goes in its place, whatever you're pulling apart. And so thinking of it as, hey, I'm just rebuilding.
Yeah.
Or rearranging.
But we've talked about the difference between demolition and reconstruction.
Yeah. And there was a phase in my reconstruction that was a full on demo mode. But you always have to demo before you remake something beautiful.
No, but the idea of demolition was I'm tearing this down without the intention of rebuilding anything.
Yeah,
so
true.
Those sometimes get conflated.
So he uses reconstruction.
Yeah.
What Zack was reluctant to call reconstruction, actually reconstruction, that healthy kind Zack talked about, is exactly what it is. And it's what must be happening since in Romans 2:2, the Bible demands it of us. So to be holding convictions for years only to realize that parts of them aren't quite holding up to reality and therefore rethinking or at least adjusting and nuancing them is something all followers of Jesus must be doing, at least if they're serious about aligning life with Scripture. And I like that, aligning life with Scripture, like how that is a little bit of that Wesleyan quadrilateral, I guess that's the bilateral part of the quad, which is like Scripture.
It's like balance, located right here, I think.
Balance with your... Did you get kicked by a horse?
Yeah.
There's like a... I know. There's like a shape. It's
very small. Yeah. It's a baby donkey kicked me.
Kicked by a small ass.
You got that cake?
Parts of them aren't holding up to reality and then rethinking or adjusting and nuancing them is something all followers of Jesus must be doing.
Yeah.
At least if they're serious about aligning life with Scripture. By being willing to challenge your faith, you're actually being faithful! Exclamation point. For all of you guys, and Scott, if he's listening.
He's not, don't worry.
Regarding Scott being in control of things and sort of directing life's details, I've begun to think of it a little differently in recent years.
Wait, you said Scott controlling things.
Did I really?
Yeah,
didn't mean to say that.
Is that a Freudian slip?
Oh, wow.
Thanks, Scott.
If you haven't been listening, Scott, you should tune into this one because there was a Freudian slip.
Scott, seriously, shut the hell up.
All right, here we go. So regarding God being in control of all things and sort of directing life's details, I've begun to think of it a little differently in recent years. I'm considering a version of where Andy was tipping his toe in the water with the idea of the absentee clockmaker, but I'm seeing things more like the pedal assist on my electric bike. I initiate and he sort of kicks in with me so long as I'm going in a good direction. Not a perfect analogy, but neither is it one that completely leaves God out of our journey. We act and he assists in response. I'm reluctant to say God never inserts himself into history in major ways, but if when he does, it's very, very, very rare. Finally, during those episodes, I thought of a quote I heard several years back. I don't remember who said it. I asked God why he tolerated so much pain and injustice in the world. He answered me saying, since you are now my body on earth, I was about to ask you the same question.
Ooh.
Mic drop, God quote.
Yeah, that...
I'm down with the pedal assist. I like that analogy.
I was thinking about that too. It like struck a second analogy in my head, like a little wind in the sails, you know? And the wind is blowing in a direction. And when you align your ship in that direction, you catch that wind in your sails.
On the note of,
oh, you're reaching into your backpack. What's he pulling? You got me some cake. You got us Christmas presents?
Oh my gosh.
I got you guys Christmas presents.
Man.
I wrapped them in aluminum foil because I was in a hurry and I didn't know where to dig out all the wrapping. But somehow I found the bows. That's okay. Weird.
Dude, this is me actively looking around the room to see if there's something I could give you. Oh, should we?
I got you a open hat.
Them. Should we open these?
Open them. It's okay. In line with the feedback.
You know, if this.
Can I guess?
If it's.
Can I guess what this is?
Sure.
I'll feel bad, actually. Is that weird that I'll feel bad if I actually guess it?
Why should you feel bad?
Because it ruins your surprise.
The surprise is me giving you a gift.
That is a surprise. Is it a book about stoicism?
It's a book about journal about Zack when you think about him.
Is it your first book that you're publishing and you didn't tell us about? Okay, let's see.
Anytime,
I'm opening mine.
Tin foil in our family is all about bacon. If there's tin foil,
you can also use that for your head for all your theories, Jeff.
It says the death of omnipotence and the birth of
omnipotence
by Thomas J. Ord.
Yep, I've read this one, and he tackles exactly what you are wrestling with right now, Andy.
Dude.
And it's a short book, but he just talks about how the idea of an omnipotent God doesn't pass the biblical test. So where do we go from there, kind of a thing? And so I think a lot of people assume God is all powerful, but his argument is that nope, it fails philosophically and ultimately it fails scripturally. So
can I read a little blurb from it that I just turned to that happened to be great? And
that's the Holy Spirit calling you to read that blurb.
Some wind in the sails.
That's how it works.
It's the assist to my pedal. It's a little section that says God cannot deny God's nature. In addition to thousands of contradictions like he listed above, we didn't read those, additional qualifications to divine power are required. Thomas Aquinas is not exactly right to say God can do all things that are possible, and for this reason, he is said to be omnipotent. Let me fast forward to some of the things that he describes that God cannot do. God cannot die. God cannot sin. God cannot lie. God cannot be deceived. So I see that he's setting up this situation to help us understand that there are some cannots when it comes to God and his nature. Dude, thank you. This is really thoughtful.
Yeah, and I want to assure the listener and also you and Jeff, this isn't this book is going to fix you, but it's helpful. And what I love about Thomas, he doesn't pretend like this doesn't answer all the questions. This is this template that you view the divine through is going to raise other questions that you haven't thought of before. The good news is, or it should be refreshing, like the idea of an all-powerful God raises a whole bunch of questions too. Any version of what you think God is raises tons of questions that And so I think this solves a lot of the evil questions, like why is there so much evil in the world, while also raising some other ones. And so it's just another tool in the tool shed for you.
Thank you, dude.
You're welcome.
I appreciate that. And I'll have a little time off, which I'm really excited about, because then I get to like actually sit down and read it. And the size of it is great. This feels like it's digestible. I could like ignore my family for a couple of days and finish the book.
Boom. Yep.
Well, my book is not your book.
No.
Because Zack,
this is hand chosen,
thought about us and specifically where would we land when it comes to books? Me being a school teacher, I'm surprised you actually got me a book because I can't read. This is how the Bible actually works. Zach's hermeneutic. You read it, do it.
You just use Zach's a big way. Word.
Dummies for math.
How the Bible actually works, in which I explain how an ancient, ambiguous, and diverse book leads us to wisdom rather than answers, and why that's great news.
Hermeneutics.
And I too will crack this open. What urgent thing is happening right now to us, our families, and our world?
Oh, that is the most Jeff line ever.
Cha-ching.
So why I thought of you when I got this book, which I've also read this book, I'm a fan of Peter Inns. He has some scholarly works and then a lot of popular works. And if you're a listener to this podcast or you're a new listener, maybe you go back to some of our old archives, you'll know that the joke has kind of been with Jeff. Like as I was deconstructing, I'm like, Jeff, just don't start reading the Bible. Don't pay attention to it. It's going to do more harm than good. Because Jeff, for those that don't know, is an experienced guy. He experienced God.
Squirrel.
He had the conversion type experience. He visited the proverbial mountaintop. And the joke was, hey, if you start paying attention to the Bible and scholarship and whatnot, it's just going to ruin that. So don't even start. However, Pete Inns is a Bible scholar that has some technical stuff. This one's not. He's got a dry sense of humor, sarcasm. It comes through in the this book.
Oh, I like that.
It's easy to read, and it's a good toe dip in the water of Bible scholarship and why, like, your pastor generally doesn't have the time, and also it would complicate things too much to bring up modern Bible scholarship when they're preaching from the Bible. Usually it's more therapeutic and devotional, and I'm not knocking that. There's a time and a place for that, but it's a good dip your toe into Bible scholarship in a fun way. And I like his approach.
Thanks, brother.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
Merry Christmas.
Can I kind of give you a gift and loan you a book?
Sure.
I've thought about it. I brought this to Hawaii. This is the one that I kept trying to like,
oh, you kept laughing, right?
I was laughing so hard. Okay, this book is called Lamb by Christopher Moore. And I'm just going to paraphrase briefly, pick some snippets out of the description. The birth of Jesus has been well chronicled, as have his glorious teachings, acts, and divine sacrifice after his 30th birthday. But nobody knows about the early life of the Son of God, the missing years, except Biff, Messiah's best bud. The story Biff has to tell is a miraculous one filled with remarkable journeys, magic, healings, kung fu, corpse reanimations, demons, and hot babes. Even the considerable wiles and devotion of the Savior's pal may not be enough to divert Joshua, Jesus' actual name in Hebrew,
Yeshua,
from his tragic destiny. But there's no one who loves Josh more, except maybe Maggie, Mary of Magdala. And Biff isn't about to let his extraordinary pal suffer and ascend without a fight. Dude, it's so funny. It's irreverent. It pulls in just enough of like biblical and historical accuracy mixed with like ridiculous comedy. If you don't laugh out loud, then you have no heart.
Yeah, we really looked for that.
Thank you.
Hard.
And I'm going to...
That's from both of us.
Thank you,
guys.
Yeah,
it's from both of us.
I really appreciate you.
Should I get Zack a present?
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Magic 8-Ball.
And we'll just let the record reflect on camera what condition the book is in. You can see it's already torn to shit, and so I will be off the hook.
It was a good deal on Amazon.
If it doesn't come back torn to shit, I'll be disappointed. Enjoy that.
Thank you.
Oh, cannot predict now, so...
Okay, it's broken. Sorry. It's no Wi-Fi. for the Magic 8 Ball.
Well, no, it just said cannot predict now.
That's so. What I said. No Wi-Fi for the Magic 8 Ball.
Oh, thank you. Sorry. I'm a little thick-headed.
What are you pulling up now?
I'm just, if now I'm, if I were to send Scott a gift as a former bro, and if you're a former bro, you're always a bro.
What's a bro?
It would be called, and he wouldn't read it. He'd probably burn it. David Bentley Hart's That All Shall Be Saved, Heaven, Hell, and Universal Salvation.
I think I just heard Scott throw up from far, far away.
He destroys the idea of eternal damnation.
All caps.
Biblically and philosophically.
Brutally destroy.
Destroys. It's insane. It's insane.
You wouldn't believe what happens. You'll never believe what DBH says in this book. ..
Okay, I'm going to run my headphones underneath your foot because I'm just getting tugged every 5 seconds.
Are you kicking his... Oh, yeah. He keeps kicking your cable there. Listener, if you don't have the video on the YouTubes, or Spotify has our video too, doesn't it, Zach?
Yes.
And props, dude. Thank you for the effort to put together the little short clips for YouTube and...
Insta.
And you're welcome.
Insta, and for the full long clips for...
I ran into a couple locals and they were like, dude,
I saw you on Insta.
I saw you.
Hey, and if you're a listener that's technically savvy and you're local and you maybe want to be a guest producer to help share the load, as the great Frodo Baggins said. Amazing. Or that was Samwise Gamgee. Please hit us up.
Frodo, let me share the load.
Speaking of feedback, Gmail, brosbiblesbeer@gmail.com, brosbiblesbeer on all the socials. Get engaged and thanks for the feedback flow. That's multiple episodes in a row.
Yeah, I know. I love the feedback. It's really nice.
It's good to hear people's thoughts.
All right. Thanks for coming, guys. Okay.
Andy. Guys, all right. Quick question for you.
Bring it.
Action. Do you have a longstanding annual recurring tradition? Maybe that's redundant. That's related to Christmas or Christmas time that you, your family, your friends, anyone that you do. And if you do, what is your favorite? Or maybe that's too strong. Just one that sticks out.
Okay, tradition. My mom for many years would always do sticky buns. Like that was her tradition. We wake up in the morning.
Sticky cake. Sticky cake. Thank you.
You call it sticky.
Sticky cake.
We do now. It's a fucking callback, Jeff. God.
Should have coordinated with you.
It's just, you guys have the same mind.
I know.
Sticky buns in the morning. Just waking up every morning. And since my mom passed a few years back, my wife took over and it's a tradition in our family. And so when my wife made it, we were kind of both in tears. I was like, they're so good. And she was like crying. I was kind of crying on the side. And I don't think I showed her that I was crying, but because I felt kind of stupid.
Because you're a man.
I'm like, they're just sticky buns, but my wife did it. So that's a really good tradition. And it's this little thing.
Yeah.
But to me and even the kids and to my wife, it's everything. So
that's cool.
If we went a year without it, it'd be like, what happened?
Hey, something's missing.
Yeah. How about you guys?
We started a new one this year. You may have heard of Elf on the Shelf, but have you heard of Snoop on the Stoop?
Oh, nice.
So Snoop Dogg.
We got a little Snoop Dogg, and he is just making his way around the proverbial stoops in our house. Wherever we can put him, he rotates in.
Now, what constitutes a stoop?
How many stoops do you have in your house?
This is the commercial for Snoop on a Stoop. Friend, what is a stoop exactly?
Oh, my gosh. What is a stoop? I don't know.
I bet Snoop never said the word stoop in his whole life.
Not in his life. You know what he did say, though, in his life for the first time ever? He's not smoking weed anymore. That's what I heard.
I think he's just vaping it now. Because he got that...
Either vaping or edibles.
He got that payday.
Oh, really? It's not like... Wasn't there something doctor related? They're like, look, your lungs are shit. And
I think there was that, but then also he like got some major deal with some vape machine company. I could be wrong, but
money talks.
Double check me on that one.
Anyway, so in past traditions, there's a reading of the book "Too Many Tamales" by my mom, and tamales are had oftentimes Mexican food on Christmas Eve.
Sounds racial.
It is racial, and it's racy, actually. It's weird. Well, there's some outfits there that some of the
if people... cake means butt, what does tamale mean? You gotta,
Jeff,
you gotta call back to your
that's a spicy tamale. As you touch yourself.
I did just like a little bit. Self-care.
Too many tamales.
We are going to edit that out.
Way too many tamales.
Andy, what about you? Traditions?
So 5-10 years ago, I started this tradition where I created my own Christmas drink. I call it a Christmas miracle, and it's one part Trader Joe's spiced apple cider that is warmed up, so it's nice and toasty, and then you do a shot of Fireball and a shot of rum.
Whoa.
When do you drink it?
When people are unwrapping their gifts but on you Christmas
mix,
morning.
You mix them all together.
14-year-old.
Yes.
14-year-old, 16-year-old. You're like, Fireball, everybody.
They're on vacation.
I've been doing it for 10. Yeah, it's for everybody.
There you go, 5-year-old.
Yeah, come on, kids. It's a Christmas miracle. You should all try it. It's delicious.
That's what they do in France.
Yeah. So in the morning, European. Fireball.
This is just for me.
Just for you. Okay, on a side note.
Yeah.
We were watching Christmas Story, You'll Shoot Your Eye Out.
Yeah,
that's right. And I never noticed it's the morning and the dad is drinking a glass of wine. I never realized that he was drinking. Anyway, it goes with your alcoholism on Christmas morning.
You know, wine is weirder than having a Christmas miracle, because mine is like this mulled, very alcoholic apple cider. That's one of them. The other one is that when Lindsay and I got married, as a joke, in our first year, we didn't have a topper, or either we did or we hadn't gone to it yet or whatever. And Lindsay had some like little costume pink hat, and she just tossed it up there, and it landed on top of the tree. And she's like, "There's our topper," and we're like, "But if you know my wife, you know that if anything happens once, it's now a tradition forever." So before our kids were ever born, now and forevermore, our Christmas tree topper is this big, like wide-brimmed pink hat.
Cowboy up or girl?
Super gay.
You don't have to worry about the star being crooked.
No, you don't. Anyway, yeah, those are a couple of fun ones.
In 5 years, what do you think the pink hat will be?
Oh,
transgender hat.
Like literally.
I don't know.
What if
something happens and then that tradition is superseded by something happening once that's cool?
Oh yeah, we can.
Is it possible that there will be a new tree topper?
Oh, you think my wife and her family allow any tradition to ever be replaced or changed? No, never. No,
it's for life. Comment. Okay,
this is traditions are for life.
All right.
I warned my sister-in-law on this when we went camping once, and she's like, "I'll make T-shirts for this year. It'll be cool." I'm like, "Don't do it." She's like, "What do you mean?" I'm like, "If you do it once, you will do it forever. So you will now be spending a couple $100 every year to make custom T-shirts for the camping trip." And she didn't believe me. And well, I enjoy my custom T-shirt every year. Sorry, Laura. I warned you.
Well, he loves it. He can't stop talking about it off the air.
My favorite one is the one that says "Camping here since 1956," and it has a map of California on it. That was a good one. She did that last year. It's a good job.
Oh, really? Nice.
Yeah.
All right. Well, what else? And other things?
You poured a little whiskey, didn't you?
I did. A little Elijah Craig.
Elijah Craig. But you didn't do any ice cubes. Why not?
I'm going neat.
Neat. All right. I got to bring up, since I came from church tonight, they do a nativity scene and then some
you did
worship.
Mention something about Jesus or whatever. And, so is he in fact the reason for the season?
Right. But the importance of Jesus being born, but then where was Jesus between zero and, you know,
this book will tell you.
Really?
This book
has all the answers.
It has all the answers.
That's why it's a national bestseller. Yeah.
Lamb by Christopher Moore tells you everything that happened before he got to 30.
They're like in high school.
Yes. Yeah. You get all his high school and college years. Jesus, the party years.
Did they? I think it's in Luke where you just get one sort of throwaway. I could be wrong about the book. I believe it's in Luke. You get a little throwaway of like Jesus as an adolescent, like sort of like a.
Well, that was Gospel of Thomas, right? That had some.
No, there's stuff in some of the apocryphal books.
That's why I said Gospel of Thomas.
Yeah. But in Luke, there is a reference to him, just a passing reference on like him growing in wisdom and such. So,
and he's teaching in the temple too. He goes and does that as a kid when the,
yeah, I think they're like amazed at his,
yeah,
learning learnedness or whatever.
But there is something about him turning doves into clay, right? In the Gospel of Thomas. What are you looking for?
I think so. It just looks like this mic stand is going to eat it.
Oh, is it falling?
As long as Jeff doesn't touch anything, we might be good. It does look like it's falling off.
No, it's good.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that. And by the way, you can just, anyone, Gospel Thomas is fair game. It's free to all. Look it up. You can read it.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, there's a little section in there where it's like younger Jesus.
Oh, he's like doing miracles and stuff as a younger. There's like
not quite like harnessing the force yet. he's doing that. And in this book, it kind of like takes that inspiration.
I like that.
And it's so funny where he's like killing lizards and then bringing them back to life and killing them again and bringing them back to life.
Yeah.
It's hilarious.
You know that picture?
Spits involved.
There's like an icon where of like Jesus in the manger and there's like the halo, there's angels around and Jesus is almost like, like floating or whatever. Jesus as a baby is almost like magic and it's God personified as a baby. And I think this is me projecting a little bit, but this is where I came from. And I think a lot of Christians like Jesus, they view Jesus as God. And so we sort of neglect the human Jesus, or what was it like boots on the ground for Jesus as a man. And that line about Jesus growing in wisdom during, I just jumped out at me when I was like sort of questioning and pulling at the threads of my faith in a way that's like, man, what does it mean for a human being to grow in wisdom? It means like trial and error, making mistakes. And that can be really uncomfortable for people to think about Jesus. Like, did he make mistakes? And I would say mistakes and sin aren't the same thing. And so growing in wisdom, the human Jesus had to grow and experience loss and pain or being wrong from time to time in a way that helped hone him and grow in wisdom. That being said, there are some wild stories. I think in some of those Gospel Thomas, I'm blanking.
That's the one that I can think of that has,
but I think there's some other ones where kid Jesus is doing miracles like willy nilly and didn't make the cut for the Bible, but
I feel like you're not listening to me.
No, I'm agreeing with you. I'm trying to
literally just said that.
I'm yes anding you.
No, but I'm yes Andy.
And additional.
It feels a little bit like how when people were like, years ago when Michael Jordan was playing, like, I want to be just like Mike. But nobody saw the like work Mike between the 20-foot jumper at the buzzer and when he, you know, the practice and the practice and the practice. It's like there had to have been something going on from birth till he walks on the scene and becomes a very public figure to the Roman Empire.
You got
to
put in that Jesus work.
And so that's where I'm
going to hit that J.
What was happening during this time? Was it a buildup and then, like God, it's like, you're going to teach, there'll be what you'll see something and you will go. And it seems like that's what happened, but I'm like, what happened?
Dude, before? You should read this because it's it's speculative and it is funny, but it does pull from historical things that were happening during that time. And even like, hey, how does someone pick a career? Like, what are you going to do? It's, well, what did your father do? Your father's a carpenter. My father's a stone layer.
Right.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't know if I want to be a carpenter. Well, maybe my father will take you in and you can try doing this too. And like, it kind of, it imagines some of those things that might've happened.
Because we see what...
And so Andy and I would like to give you this for Christmas. And so Andy, you'll have to come up with another gift for me.
Systematic theology. I think that has your name on it.
Uh-huh. We see in the Bible what Jesus does and is doing in the environment that he's in. And so we can point to those things, but there's the if people... It's like, how do I end up being like Michael Jordan? Dude, you've got to practice nonstop, and be born with a little bit of genetics. And it's like,
but mostly genetics.
Yeah. Jesus, also God. But prior, there had to have been, speculation. That's all it is. Cause I don't, if there's somebody out there in the world or a listener that,
Is still alive and you were back then. Can you leave feedback?
Listener, Jeff is the oldest guy we know, and he doesn't go back as far as Jesus. So if you know anybody that does,
if you can have them leave some feedback of what it was like back then, or you could just tell us, it's probably close enough, Jeff.
You broke my prayer.
Were you just praying for me to stop interrupting you?
No, I'm like, please don't go passive aggressive.
Hey, I like the Elijah Craig, by the way. I feel like this is a bang for your buck whiskey.
It is a good one.
Bourbon, I mean. Bang for your buck bourbon.
Were you finished? Keep going, though.
No.
I sort of derailed you a little bit.
This past week, I've been listening to some things and being at church tonight. I'm just thinking of like the power of Jesus, and people are like, you want to be more like Jesus. It's like, well, what did Jesus do? And it's like, we don't actually get to see what he did to prepare himself to get to where he then, you know, we see in Acts so many things happening. It's like, are we missing the golden nugget that will then catapult us to like another spiritual level? I mean, obviously not Jesus, but, you know, we've mentioned many times, like you don't really see these miracles out in the world today, as Jesus was performing, and so, like healing the lame and the blind, and so it's, I'm like, is there more?
I'm not trying to give you a perfect answer because there isn't one, but maybe something that's helpful is like, so where are the teachings where Jesus is like addressing the question that you're asking? Where he's like engaging with people and as they're coming to him, kind of saying like, so what do I do? How do I get there? And being able to say, I know we talked about it before, but the rich young ruler, like for him, it was specific. Hey, the guy says, I've done all these things. I think I've done the right things, right? And he's like, you need to do this one more. And he tells him that specifically because it's like that's he knows in the man's heart that's what's holding him back. But I think there's general versions. At least the way that I read the Bible, there's general versions where Jesus is telling us like, hey, here's some things to do. Like here's some patterns to follow.
I've heard some interesting interpretations too on the story of Jesus.
Be perfect as I am perfect. Just that.
Oh yeah, okay. I never thought about that.
Yeah, and it's okay. and I don't bring it up because
why don't you do that?
I'm gonna go back and if I do what Jesus did before he then performed these miracles, then I can do it. That's not really. It's more out of curiosity. Like nobody really talks about or even asks the question. I mean, I know the question is asked in some circles of like, what was going on before this?
Well, you've got approximately 30-ish years to get there.
Right.
From the point that you became a Christian. Zack and I are way past it. So we've clearly blown it since we're beyond the 30-year mark. You've got some time.
Oh, yeah. I was born Christian.
Yeah. So take it easy.
Hashtag born this way, bitch.
So I'm really like 11 years old.
Yeah.
And Christian.
You've got so much time.
Or is it dog years? And I'm really like,
well, Jesus 70. Wasn't a dog, I don't think. So I think you're okay.
Okay, great.
Yeah, you've got like 20-ish years to go. He started his ministry when he was 30. Yeah, you're fine.
There, you know what's wild too is some of the Christmas narrative of like the manger and the wise men, the angels coming to the shepherds. We kind of mash everything together.
Here Zack goes, just ruining the story. Go ahead, Zack.
Go ahead, shit on the nativity.
We just shit-tivity.
Everybody needs to take 90% of their nativity.
Shit on nativity.
I said shit on the nativity.
Shit-nativity.
Just go ahead. Go for it.
I'm trying to enhance tivities. Trying to bring out the life in the tivity.
The tivity. Oh, no. I'm sorry, listener. I'm sorry. I'm more sorry, viewer. Good to see that.
But what you do, and I get it. Like at church, you're combining everything. But the average person that doesn't read the Bible, it's like Luke says a bunch of things about the birth. Matthew is the other one that does the birth. And the details don't line up. And so if you're looking for it to be like, oh, this is the historical, the way the birth happened, it just put them side by side. It won't work. But that's the point isn't like you can't believe it or if it's not true. The point is like when you combine them all or try to harmonize them all, you're creating a new Christmas narrative. Whereas Luke had specific ideas in mind when he wrote his birth narrative, Matthew as well. Mark, which is the earliest gospel, doesn't really mention anything. There's no virgin birth. And all these things that like, once you start paying attention to,
let's see, Mark, earliest gospel. Okay.
Yeah. It's probably in there.
Jeff jots down. Mark is a gospel.
Okay.
Got it.
I've got that Jeopardy question.
Now I'll go look up gospel next and see what that word means.
The oldest gospel.
Cool. What is a gospel?
That's a good question.
What even
but
is
Christmas is like ultimately, and I love it. And then John, probably the latest gospel is like, oh, like virgin birth, hold my beer. This is like, this dude was the creator beyond time and space. Like in the beginning was the word was God, word with God. And he's like, Jesus goes beyond all time and space as creator God, which is just like cosmically mind blowing. In a way that's like totally unhuman. That's like all mystery, God experience.
Cosmic Jesus.
And they all had very different reasons for writing those things, which is fascinating. And like, and those are some of the details where they don't line up. That's what ignorant, I'm not saying all atheists are ignorant, but the ignorant variety of atheists that read it fundamentally, kind of like a conservative fundamentalist, they hold those details against the text and say, this proves the Bible's not true. That's not the point. The point is Luke had an agenda for what he was writing. Matthew did too. And perspective too. Agenda can sound negative, but I think it's technically correct. I'm not using it as a derogatory,
maybe
towards the text. That's what my heart tells me, Andy.
Oh, believe it.
But
my heart says I'm Michael Jordan.
Oh my gosh. You know what's great about that? The Michael Jordan thing, to go back to that, is like, yeah, guess what? He has more, it's not equal. He has more talent like from the starting point. But guess what? I think there's like countless guys in sports leagues that have world-class talent that don't put the work in the way he did.
And that's true. When you combine those, it's like the very few: LeBron, Kobe, Michael, Magic, Bird.
Yeah,
and then Kareem, and then it like steeply drops off after that. But yeah, it reminds me of that quote from Animal Farm,
mm-hmm.
where I forget which animals are talking to each other. But one says, "Hey, all animals are created equal. It's just that some are more equal than others."
That quote was in Animal Farm.
Yeah, it's an Animal Farm.
And now we're going to go into a segment called "Who Are Our Favorite Kids?" Right
yes.
Now. Jeff, you go first.
Da 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 da. Kid of the week.
A young goat.
You have a goat kid?
Isn't it called a kid? Well, yes, it is, but I think Andy is right.
Da-da-da, you made it weird.
Went the academic route.
The ability, and I wonder, like, you're going back to, like, what are we missing from... We're missing time. Like, how did it actually look, or what did Jesus do?
What's the process to becoming more like Jesus, I think, is what you're getting to, right? Like,
and how did Jesus do always. That?
And how did Jesus become more like Jesus? It is, though. Like, it's...
So maybe he's born. Obviously, he's different.
Jordan got cut from his sophomore team in high school.
And then he's probably like, F that. No more. Hashtag never forget. Time never again.
Speaking of goats.
Oh! Nice. Yeah, and he probably had his cake and ate it too, Jeff. Am I right?
That got gross.
That was gross.
Yeah.
I don't know what's happening.
Being more like Jesus.
Yeah.
Same obviously.
Brain. I know.
I don't think, obviously, even if we see what Jesus does, and I don't know if he catches himself out in the world back then, where we catch ourselves like, oh, I shouldn't have said that, or I should be doing this. I'm gonna regret not doing that. I know I should be going over here. Like, I don't know if Jesus, do you think Jesus went through that? Like, oh, this is like, I'm a human. So
like learning to be a human.
But in his, oh gosh. It's like you're pointing to the Bible or something.
I'm
telling
you, man. I'm going to go ahead and put this book down for now.
It's so funny that you keep mentioning it because it does, it describes the stuff that we would be thinking about. Like those questions that you're asking, like, well, what would, it imagines what that would be like. So does Jesus know exactly what his purpose is supposed to be? Or is he like stumbling into it along the way? Oh, I think there's something I'm supposed to be.
The woman at the well, wandering up there, meeting her at this point, and then speaking life into her. And it the trajectory of a life goes in this way, and it's exponential, and it changes others. Because of like, I can't believe you're the same person. And that affects everybody. So Jesus doing that starts a movement in with that person, and it's a catalyst. So I know there has to be those moments where we certainly can be encouraging people and speaking life into them and giving them some direction and guidance with the, like, I see this in you. Like,
yeah.
You're phenomenal at this.
You know what's cool about that, that you reminded me of, is the way that he, like, does this, he being Jesus, like, this sweet balance between, he calls her out, right?
Yes.
He's like, go take this to your husband. And she's like, I have no husband. He's like, I know.
Yeah. I'm glad you said that because I already knew that.
Yeah, but the culmination of that interaction isn't one where she leaves feeling like wounded, or, you know, like Jesus isn't for her.
She's seen.
Yeah, she's seen, but it's this this almost like magical balance of where he's able to like call out the truth and challenge her on like the reality of things, and yet encourage her into life, into goodness. And that, dude, I see that, and like I'm kind of baffled. There, I feel like there's very few people I know who I've encountered who can do that kind of thing.
Well, I can only think back to 8-9 years ago where I just stopped in some parking lot and prayed for some guy that was in a truck, and he was like, I needed that so much, and like, thank you. And that was that. And I have no idea what happened. There was something else at a Starbucks, and but ultimately,
how many husbands did he have though that you called him out on? Like, that's the point.
But I,
that's exactly the point, Andy. Thank you.
Yeah,
there's the natural way, and then there's being at church, and all of a sudden the person on stage says, "Okay, I want you to just go and walk up to people if you feel you sense that." You know, you can pray for them a certain way. And
I hate those.
And next thing I know, I've got somebody giving me a very generic prayer.
The Lord loves you. And
you're
he's for Jeff. You.
And I'm like, I'm like,
Jeff.
Yes.
And he forgives you for what you looked at last night.
It's not your fault. It's not your fault.
I know.
Jeff, it's not your fault.
Yeah, no.
Jeff, it's not your fault.
I'm getting emotional for reals,
Jeff.
Like, actually for reals.
Jeff's eyes are welling up.
I know. I'm getting a little emotional too because I think
it's, you know,
Zack.
It is my fault.
Some of it. Some of it is your fault.
Okay. Did this happen tonight?
No.
Okay.
I don't like that.
The point I am bringing up is that I do not like the, oh, we're going to like, okay, now
manufactured moment.
Don't tell me what you, if you came up with some idea, it'd be like something at work. Ah, I got this idea. It's like, okay, then you go and do this. Or like you're at your church and like, I had this thought. It's like, great. What do you need from me? Then you go do it. We're not going to like kind of create this moment. When it's there, I think this is what Jesus did. When it was there, it was like, I've got to go. And this is what I'm going to do. And if, you know, you do this and like that will be helpful. And so there's this process or just this day to day of just sensing and coming across people. And you're like, I've got to grab this moment, whether it's at a Starbucks or wherever.
Full circle. Then how do you cultivate recognizing when the wind is in your sails?
You've got to be completely present with your surroundings. You've got to be listening.
Like a survivor man.
Whatever.
Ready.
I don't know.
To be attacked by a bear at any moment.
You just have to, if you were on guard in the wilderness, like I got to make sure, you know, where's the bear? But out in our world, seriously, at a Starbucks or just on the road or at work.
It's like being expectant almost, right?
You're just waiting for the proverbial shoe to drop and send you in the direction with the wind.
Yeah, like what are being open to the possibilities? One.
And sometimes it gets weird. Like,
well, yeah. And there's
maybe more often than not.
But there's versions of it. Jeff, your personality is if you are...
Don't discount yourself, Zack.
Amped up for like, oh my God. When you're fired up...
I'm fired up now.
Okay. When you're fired up for little baby Jesus and you're like, what do you want me to do? What? And you're open to that in the world.
8 pounds, 6 ounce. Yep.
You have a muscle that a lot of people can't get to in terms of...
Come on.
It's good.
Stay with it. In terms of like talking to people, engaging with people in a way that you might be out of your comfort zone,
yeah,
but you're still in your wheelhouse. But I want to encourage, so I'm more introverted and oftentimes it's very easy for me to, whether I'm at Costco,
right here,
a Starbucks,
that this spoke life into me. I mean, this is, this is your way.
You haven't read it yet.
No. This is the way.
Yeah. It could be total shit.
How do you know? You don't know. Well,
it tells you how that Bible works.
Once you
read, I'm sorry.
No, but Jeff, trust me. He knows that I've thought about, not just buying you a book.
I'm pointing out your way. Maybe this is my fuel to keep doing what I do. And me just receiving this is like encouragement to like, I'm going to keep doing this for other
people. I mean, he's not going to read it. Just receiving it is enough.
Right. And then maybe he'll send me a selfie when he's sipping coffee in the morning and like it's sort of there visible in the picture. So
Great book.
It's right there.
See, hey, look, the Bible.
It's a book.
Marcus, he was the oldest.
I have gospel. Your book, Marcus.
But there are people that don't. It's very difficult to engage with strangers in that way. But there are versions of it for the introverts where you can like get outside your comfort zone and just make the world a little bit better.
Can I even up that and say it's even as hard to like do that with people that you know, not even just people you don't know. In some ways, maybe easier with people you don't know because you're like, well, if this goes south, oh well, I never see this person again.
Correct.
With someone that you do know, oh, I gotta see you next week.
Okay, this is, it's not even in the same arena, but it's the idea of like, you know, I'm gonna say something or I'm gonna ask a question or whatever.
See something, just, say something.
Yeah. God, I want to throw up. I hear this at school. Just like someone delete that phrase.
We'll edit that out.
Thank
See
you.
See cake, say cake.
COVID 23.
23. 23 and me.
I'm at church. We're doing worship and everybody is deadpan in their seats.
What?
And we're on song 3.
They're all doing their Zack impressions.
And I'm like, what? And in me just is welling up like,
did you touch down Jesus stand, them into it?
Like stand.
Yeah.
And so start here.
But ultimately I'm in my head. I'm uncomfortable. I'm sitting next to my wife. I'm like, if we were Sunday service, my wife would be up. I would probably be up. Why is there a burden on the whole church?
The lights were dark probably.
Yeah.
It was a mood was being set.
But we're many, many songs in. Yeah. And
that's okay.
Spiritual oppression was
so
going on.
A couple people were up and then I'm like, I'm going to stand up. No more than 5 minutes went by. After I stood up, the whole row in front of me, which was the front row, left. And the two people behind me left.
Good job, Jeff. Way
what
to go.
What do you smell like?
Yeah.
What happened when you stood up? Did you just unleash?
I'm telling you, something was going
on.
Was
there something afoot?
I have no idea, but they didn't belong there. Well, I want to know what got them to just... I stood up because I'm like, I feel like need to go. And
you're responding.
And I was uncomfortable. Nobody's staying. I got all my kids there, my daughter's boyfriend. And I'm like, we're all just sitting here. I'm like, I'm singing, but I don't hear anybody else singing. And I saw somebody out of the corner of my eye stand. And I'm like, at least somebody's into this.
But then they were walking out to go to the bathroom. So
they stood. And then, so I stand up. Next thing I know, there's like mass exodus. And like, who cares? But there's like this.
You do a little bit.
There's this uncomfortableness of standing, everybody's sitting, and you're going to stand. But ultimately, isn't that, I kind of think of it as like, Jesus was always rocking the boat, always going against the tide. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, and that's kind of where I'm called. So that's part of,
I think that's okay. I think there's maybe, have you ever not felt uncomfortable standing up during worship?
No. I mean, yes.
I mean, well, how about,
I agree with you.
Let me dial it back a little bit. Is it uncomfortable more often than not to stand up?
Yeah, I'm the sit guy. Like that's authentic to me plus I'm nonconformist by nature. So if they say everybody stand up, I'm like, F that, I'm going to sit down.
Yeah, but you're conforming.
They're called naughty, just sitting naughty by nature, not nonconformist.
Gosh, Jeff,
by nature.
Jeff just ruined it.
The next time I see you in the audience, as opposed to playing guitar and, drums, I'm gonna look over to you. Bass. Actually, I'm just gonna come over. Okay, sorry, I'm not a musician. Yeah, just call me out. Yeah, I'm an idiot.
All of them.
When it comes to music.
No, I'm just adding two. I'm yes anding you.
Okay, whatever. Yeah. Yes, Andy.
We're filling out the check.
Yes, and
filling out the checklist.
Yes, and yes, Andy. I'm gonna move myself over to wherever you are.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna be like, could I help you up, sir? Nice. I will do this next time.
Okay.
I'm gonna find you.
Do it. I won't be in the sanctuary because I'll see you coming.
I'm gonna bring you into the light.
But in answer to Andy's question, it's I've never been the raised hand. That's mine, but go ahead. It's too late.
Community beer.
Bonk.
That's a new drop,
new
guys.
New jingle. And so I don't know. I don't help. If there is a group participation where things build and there's energy in the room, sometimes this happens. Definitely happens at a rock at like a concert, but occasionally in worship where people are in it. It's the campfire effect.
You split the sea, so I walk. Oh, Zach standing.
No, I'm the guy that will never contribute to that momentum just because I'm just sitting and I can't help myself. I'm looking at the stage because okay. I'm usually up there. And so I'm like, what is this person doing? What are they doing?
Oh, that's brutal.
And I don't think that's like, I view it as a part of worship. Like, I don't look at music as worship anyway. Music is just a part of what we do. Worship is like, how are you humaning in general? That's worship. Like, how are you
humaning?
God hates you.
Well placed, Andy. How does I'm going to harness some Thomas Merton here. How does a tree worship God? If you were to surmise, how does a tree
with his arms up? That's how they go.
He's like, have some oxygen. Yeah, God. Baby.
A stupid question is that. Yeah, that's how trees work.
God, such a non-conformist.
Look at this. I'm exactly like a tree. My fingers are out like this.
Zack,
the branches.
You guys found the loophole. Congratulations.
Yeah.
Zack, I get it. You actually are the opposition of me in the same thing, in the same thought. I'm like, let's go. And when everybody goes, you're like, right here. Because I just need to be myself.
I'm absorbing. Yes. And a tree worship, an animal worships by being an animal with no shame, no guilt. There's nothing. And so in our best, when we are humans at our best and things are clicking, there is shalom in our life. There is no guilt or shame. And even when you make mistakes, if your posture is like totally dialed into your acceptance, you're accepted by God, like instantly you recognize the wrong, but you're not like creating a shame spiral of being guilty. And so like worship to me is worship as music on Sunday mornings is, I think it does more. The idea of if people think that's when worship happens, that's a mistake. And that I wouldn't mind correcting that a little bit for people. That is a part of being.
I mean, what do you mean that music at church is?
I'm not saying that's a mistake. I'm saying if you're going to church now, I will worship now. Oh, this is when I'm worshiping.
God doesn't make mistakes.
Understood.
So I don't know what you're talking about.
Like, is that Kip? Chip? Who's the guy from Napoleon Dynamite? Kip.
Napoleon Dynamite.
Guys.
Right, it's like
Excuse me, but I don't think you're exactly getting it right.
To just knock the Catholic Church a little bit. It's like we go on Sunday, we're good for the week, then I'll go and repent and do an Our Father and a Hail Mary and then I can get out of there and I'm good. The rest of the week, whatever.
I think there's people in Catholic Church that do that for sure, but somebody like Kat Von D who just converted.
Theo Von, did you listen to that interview?
When was she on there?
Just recently.
Oh, no.
No, it's good.
No, I know. I need to listen to that. I'm disappointed in myself.
Kat Von D, she was on LA Inc. That was her like reality show. She was a heavy duty, a major tattoo artist, but was kind of into the occult. She dated Nikki Sixx from Motley Crue for a while. Like, was kind of a dark person, dark personality. And 100% conversion and accepted Christ, moved to Indiana, lives in this little small town, goes to a
tiny, small church.
Is starting to black out her tattoos. She has too many tattoos to remove. And so she's just like
full, it's like full blacked out.
She's
sleeves.
Doing blackface on her body. She's
nope.
She's not doing
not that. No.
Black she's, sleeves to cover it up.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
She's and doing she black like, body.
She talked about.
I'm which listening is, to you and I'm watching Andy's reaction.
Which is worse? I don't know. No, but it is, it's actually a pretty touching story because she was like into witchcraft and the occult, like definitely into the dark side of tattoo art world, etc. And to hear her talk about it, the encouragement that I get from that is like, dude, if that person can recognize Jesus for who he is and want what Jesus has for her life, I feel like I've set really low standards for other people and just thought, oh, well, there's no chance. Why would I even waste my time trying to like show Jesus to this person? And it's a cool story. So I'd recommend like go check it out. Kat Von D. She was a pretty intense personality. And it's like, again, if you think about someone like, it's pretty far over on the, I'm not interested in anything God side of things to, no, I believe deeply in Jesus and I'm dedicating my life to following Christ. I mean, relatively new Christian, so I don't want to put too much on.
Yeah. And her I plate. Would, the reason she came to mind when you were talking about Catholicism is that she is Catholic, right? That's right.
Not now.
No, but I thought she's cat, like that's
Protestant.
Her.
Oh, she might have been raised originally, like early when
no,
she
I
was younger.
I thought she was going to a Catholic church. Uh-uh. But regardless, like some of the Catholic or Eastern Orthodox, some of these more high church experiences, the reason I brought her up is like, because I thought she was going to a Catholic church. Some people need that practice that when you, and me, like I need some practices because I don't always have the feels of I feel God or I feel connected or if, you know, God's definitely real tangibly in my life. So the practices of some of these high church things where it's the sights, the smells, the incense, you're doing some of the ritual stuff that can kind of seem rote and like, oh, you're just checking boxes. And certainly a lot of people are just checking boxes. Let's be honest. Most Protestants are checking boxes because they show up at Christmas and Easter and not much else. But some people need that practice of, and that's okay. That's a version of worship that is tangible and real.
Yeah. And that's, well,
I love when we just casually just throw people underneath the bus. I'm like, you're just checking boxes. I wish we had those people in front of us.
Well, some people are.
No,
Ricky,
completely.
Ricky,
check boxes.
I'm talking to you
sometimes. Like I'm guilty of it for sure.
Well, I love
how the last two sentences I said I ended with
Have I told that story of being in college and going to?
Could you check my liquor box and get me like several ice cubes out of that and put them in here? Check that box.
Check.
Will you grab those cubes?
You use your hands.
Since I gave you COVID-23, I wanted you to.
That's like the Michael Jordan of COVID.
I've been working on it hard.
Get it?
Before 43.
23. Michael Jordan's number.
23.
It was funnier. You should have laughed hard. Anyway, did I tell you guys the story of when I was in college and I went to a, it was a Friday night. It was in Seattle. And a friend of mine took me to this cathedral, and there were these monks doing Gregorian chants, and it was 11 o'clock at night on a Friday, and the place was packed.
Christmas Eve, or is this
just a normal Friday in the summer, and the place was packed with college students.
What?
Like sitting, kneeling, praying, and these Gregorian monks were chanting.
I bet that was wild.
Were you at Rock Harbor?
Dude, no, this is in Seattle.
Oh, sorry.
And it was wild. It was a weird experience and it was powerful, but the similar sort of thing, like maybe it was this weird mix of like liturgical traditional services that people would go through, but at the same time was so out of the ordinary. And I think there was something to that, that people were attracted to. You just wouldn't expect that like college students on a Friday night would be attracted to something like that. And I remember it took me a little bit to warm up to it. Like your reactions alone let me know your experience and what I experienced a little bit. You're like, really?
I could see that being, they didn't even have beer there. Pretty amazing. Oh, monks, 100% they had beer there.
Not these monks.
They didn't allow you to have it.
But. Right, they had it. That's how they were just singing so good. But yeah, no, but there is something to, so what they were doing was some tradition that was, I don't know, hundreds of years old, that they were singing these Gregorian chants. And there's candles around and I don't, again, it was some cathedral, whether it was Catholic or, what's the closest one? Episcopal? Lutheran? One of those two is close.
Probably Episcopal.
Episcopal is pretty close. Doesn't matter.
Lutheran's kind of high churchy too. Lutheran qualifies.
It was very high churchy, but it was powerful. And things other, like these candles that were there made a part of the experience. Mm-hmm. But like, I know it's silly, but this was part of the, like, the theology of architecture, of building high ceilings that were pointing people's like eyes towards heaven, and it was designed for the greatness of God. We saw this when we went to Paris and like looked at all the cathedrals, and that was because a lot of people couldn't read, and so they were trying to like give them glimpses of God's greatness, even in, down to the architecture.
Yeah.
So it was. That still sticks out to me as a memory of something that like I would not do normally. This is obviously something that's not new and special in terms of like you didn't invent anything, but it was still meaningful, and it still took me about like 20 or 30 minutes to like get into it.
Yeah. Diversity of this, the streams of diversity of the way people experience God is wild, because
do you think they were experiencing God?
Totally. Yeah.
Yeah,
I do.
Oh, you were there.
Okay, and who's to say? I just went there. Andy painted a wonderful picture with his tongue.
I think they were.
And maybe some of them were, some of them weren't. Like, that's what I struggle with. I'm guilty of is like, hey, I found this new toy, i.e. like a way I look at the world and I'm really excited about. Therefore, like, if anyone's not as excited as I am, like, I want... Like, what's wrong with them? They're not doing it. Like, I become a version of an evangelical for a different thing in a way that I would hate about my old self. So struggling with the, like, why aren't people worshiping like me? Or why don't people see things the same way I do? Like, just learning to accept, like, I don't know, maybe the people in the room with you, Jeff, were just, for whatever reason, they were in a mode, and then the lights and the atmosphere was tamping down any exaltation or like, let's get up and like really worship God. This music is amazing. And you weren't there. You were just in a spot like, oh my gosh, I'm so fired up. This is so great. These people aren't with me, but maybe they are, just in a different way.
Yeah.
Maybe. And then maybe a couple of them are checking a box.
Maybe they were a bunch of sinners being convicted and they were sitting in their sin and conviction.
Maybe they're thinking about all the tattoos they needed to black out.
Yep, that's probably right.
All 1,300 people.
Yeah.
Okay.
I
all 13 and 100 people.
When I heard that Kat Von D is like getting rid of her old tattoos, I got sad a little bit. And you guys tell me if this is wrong.
That's wrong.
And it's not wrong, because there's no right or wrong anymore. It's there's sin doesn't matter and everything is relative.
Wrong.
Nobody gets asked questions
shut
anymore.
Up, Zack.
those are like it's like signposts on your life journey. And I think there will be a time in Kat Von D's faith where she feels a little bit of regret of like, no, that's where I was at the time. And that's okay. That was part of my journey.
Yeah, but why do you need to wear that quite literally on your sleeve for the rest of your life? Well, maybe her new sleeves are her new steps on her journey, if we're going to really extend your metaphor.
Yeah, maybe. And so that's where I, you know, I could be wrong, but my current opinion is like, don't try to like eliminate your past. Your past happened. It is a part of why you are the way you are. Include it in where you're going.
I don't think
if you, only as a reminder.
Can I challenge the logic a little bit?
I invited it.
Okay. If you and Lisa got divorced and you got remarried, would you wear your old wedding ring?
That's a symbol of marriage.
To?
Somebody that you're not with anymore, so that symbol is gone.
Right. So would you still wear it? But that was a big part.
No, I wouldn't.
That's part of your life.
Right. But that's an easy one.
That's why I chose the example.
But that would be very offensive to and disrespectful to
if I kept
your
wearing
current
it.
Wife.
So what about if there's an upside down cross on your arm that's been tattooed there? Is that not offensive?
Get your really arm off. Good at doing handstands. I would do handstands a lot, and then I would develop really good shoulders.
But you get where I'm going, right? Like,
oh yeah.
My point is, I'm trying to say that it's okay to say, hey, there's a part of my history that has shaped me, but I don't need to broadcast it.
Right. No, I agree with you. And the only thing I would say is, I think there's like this line is going to be different for everybody. There's an unhealthy version of disassociating from your past in a way that doesn't allow you to accept that it happened, and therefore you have further wounds. So for Kat Von D, it's like, that was my initial response. It's like, oh man, it's like, no, that was a part of you that happened. And you have a story to tell of like that. Now, maybe it is because so much of her body real estate is already covered by tattoos. If you don't know who she is,
really?
She's
tattoos, a lot of tattoos everywhere.
So maybe there isn't a version of like, oh, I had a few tattoos. I could tell a story of like, yeah, I was such an idiot when I got this one. I lost a bet and whatever it is. She can't make new tattoos to signify her journey because there's not much space, I don't think.
I guess if she got asked the question, it's a past life.
Well, she's such a public figure for her.
There's always a story.
Yeah, I'll make a speculation here. I would guess that most of covering up those tattoos is for her because everybody, because she's been so public for so long. It's not for everybody else. It's just like, hey, when I look in the mirror every day, I don't want to see that. Yeah. I don't want to be reminded of that.
It stops you in your tracks.
I don't want to be reminded of mistakes. I don't want to be reminded of past life. That's pain. Why would I want to be reminded of pain?
Yeah.
I'd rather.
No, that's a really good point. Yeah. No. No.
Is that a motivation? Like, if you woke up every day and you're reminded of your past, it's a mistake you made, or this is whatever. If the tattoos,
it's not biblical. We're not called to be constantly reminded. Like,
it in the past.
What's the verse? Like, as far as the east is from the west, that's how far God has removed our transgressions from us. Like, the point is, don't sit in there. Don't sit in your prior sin, is what God is trying to tell you. He's forgiven you for those things. Don't be stupid and continue them, but they shouldn't be. They shouldn't be an anchor that is weighing you down.
Yeah. When you realize the weight of your mistake, and most of the times mistakes, you don't just make them and like, oh, well, I'm good now. I got off with that. It's like, no, or I got away with that.
Yeah.
Probably rephrase that.
Maybe but, also that.
But also included. But there's often consequences that you're dealing with. And so I think what I'm trying to touch on is like, you can't just like, oh, that didn't happen. You can't just deny that. That's a part of you. And so there's a healthy way of moving forward, recognizing it. You're holding that. You're holding a little bit of space in the things that you did in the past that you regret.
That's like,
and you learn from it.
Yeah, that's forgiveness and reconciliation.
Yeah.
Right. And that means that like you dealt, I think in my mind, I define reconciliation as like you dealt with the thing.
Yeah.
And you are, you've been able to move past it.
I was listening to Matt Chandler message from a couple of weeks ago, and he was talking about, you know, sin and, you know, don't even, when you, if you were new, if you're here and you're like, I can't be a Christian, like I've done so many bad things, it'd be like, yeah, your sin doesn't size up to David, you know, cheated with somebody's wife and had that husband killed. It's like, you're totally fine. But the, oh my God, lost my train of thought. It just disappeared.
Chandler, David,
Bathsheba,
your sin doesn't add up to that.
Reconciliation.
Hey, whatever you've done right now, you're not a shithole like David was back in the day. Even he was a man after God's own heart in spite of that stuff.
Keep it going.
Don't be a shit ass like David.
Don't be a shit ass. Don't be a shit cake.
Yeah, don't be a shit cake.
Shit cake.
Don't be a shit cake like David.
So I totally lost my freaking train. You might think, man,
you're a shit cake just like David. I assure you, you're not.
Well, maybe you are.
I'm dwelling. We're into Hugh Hauser a little bit.
You could find yourself as a shit cake. Oh my goodness. That's amazing.
That's a fascinating tale.
Tell me more about it.
I'll go with it. Here on California's Gold.
Oh, look at this. I found a nugget of gold in the shit cake. Oh, God.
Shout out to Elliot Gould.
Gosh darn it.
No.
No, no, no. Dana Gould.
Dana Gould.
other Gould.
Elliot Gould's an
actor.
Yeah.
And he's very...
He's terrible.
Not funny.
No.
God, brain
Dana
fart.
Gould is
Dana Gould.
Hilarious. And he does a great Hugh Hauser.
He does the best Hugh Hauser, and he's the fastest comedian.
Wow.
That's good.
What were you guys talking about 3 minutes ago?
Shit cakes.
No, God. No. Dang it.
Reconciliation and being able to recognize sin in your past, but not have it be a daily reminder that God has told us that he has forgiven our sins and views them as far as the east is from the west. That's how far he's removed our transgressions from us. I only remember that because of that really, man, that shoehorned in worship song years ago. Remember that? As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he has removed our transgressions from us.
It had something to do with covering up the, you know, tattoos? Your past, yeah, the tattoos. And
well,
I can't. I
feel like Mouse Rat could cover that song.
It does feel like that, doesn't it?
Anyway, well, what are you guys consuming?
Well, yeah, we probably should
move
land
into
this plane. One other thing I thought I had about Christmas and deconstruction.
Zack, thank you.
Scott, man, I miss you.
Scott from the grave.
We should phone him in once.
Scott, seriously, shut the hell up. Thank
you're
you.
You're right. We shouldn't. No. He should never come back on.
Shut up, Scott.
Never.
We have more drops saying shut up.
I don't have any drops. I have no drops.
I know.
I feel like I'm dropless.
I feel like you have to be the... Okay, we'll talk about that later.
Yeah.
One thing that I noticed when I was really struggling with the doctrine of hell and what does hell mean? What is it? Is it actually a thing? And not speaking on the merits of what anybody thinks about that right now, but the birth narratives of Jesus being born, the incarnation, it's all good news. And it just, when I was thinking about and struggling with that, the idea of the Prince of Peace and just like good news for all people, the announcement, there's not a whiff of like good news or else.
Right.
You know, receive this gift of this little baby boy or else. It's not there.
But if you don't.
Now, I know that doesn't, I know there's plenty of biblical text to wrestle over that if that's triggering where you're like, yes, but there has to be punishment for sin, all that stuff. I get it. And we can talk about that at a different time. But it's worth noting. It's if it was good news with caveats, it's not in the birth narratives. So whatever that means, that was really refreshing to me. And I, growing up hearing those stories, you don't think about it. You just assume like, well, there's all these things are one in one big template. And then it just came, the idea of actual good news being born, just came to life in a way post deconstruction for me. So
that's sweet, dude. I like that.
Thanks.
No, I don't mean like, that's sweet. I just mean it's...
No, I believe you. Yeah. I believe you. Yeah. It's a sweetness.
No, it is a sweetness.
I lost it a little bit at the end. You're playing that song? You're playing at Radiant.
I am. This, I'm playing... Oh, no, not at Beechwood. I am playing at Radiant Bruco, though.
Where's the Radiant can?
No. I'm not playing at Radiant. I'm playing at Green Cheek.
Oh, Green Cheek.
Oops. Sorry, Radiant.
I played a Radiant before, though.
If you hear this in Southern California, because this will come out before the 22nd of December, yep. Andy will be playing with a cover band, a good time at Green Cheek Brewing Company in Orange?
In Orange, yeah. Out in Orange. It'll be fun.
All right, what are we consuming?
Gotta learn some songs.
Yeah, what are you guys consuming? Andy?
Can I go last?
Zack? Well, Andy's going to be consuming this book, and then Jeff's going to be consuming this book.
I'll be consuming pictures of the book.
Okay. Honestly, I re-listened to on Audible The Death of Omnipotence, Thomas J. Ord. And it was like, honestly, I didn't think about getting you guys these books until after we recorded, when Andy, you're really... your heartfelt sort of just honesty of, you know, wrestling with a lot of things. One of them being which, like, your idea of what God is might be shifting, in a transformative way. I'm like, oh, I got that book on Audible. And so I listened to it and I was like, I'm going to buy Andy that book. It'll give you a new template. And if you're, most Christians are either like, well, God has a plan, and or it's like, well, we have free will, and also God has a plan. And so there's some logical inconsistencies there.
Yeah.
God has a plan and has planned everything, and it's all going according to his plan, the good and the bad. And then most Christians are like, well, there's free will, but sometimes God subverts free will.
Yeah.
And so this is a third way where it's like, no, it doesn't add up, and here's why.
Did Thomas J. Ord ever come on the podcast?
Yeah.
Who's the dude that we met at Docent that one time, the bigger dude? Remember?
We met Fabie. Bob Fabie. Shout out to Bob Fabie.
Is he connected to Thomas?
I don't know.
Okay. I don't think so. I mixed them up in my head.
I don't think so.
Sorry.
But
I'm looking forward to it, man. I promise to read it over break for sure. Thank you. That's very, very kind of you.
And also, I think I mentioned before, but I'm Martyr Made Podcast by Daryl Cooper is a fantastic history podcast, and he's got a crazy free audiobook length 6-part series on. It's called something about New Jerusalem. It's about the history of Israel, Palestine, and it is so in depth and it's very long, and it's worth your time though, if you want more of that. And I think I mentioned that before, but I'm continuing to, if I'm repeating myself, I'm continuing to churn through that. So.
Oh, I'm consuming nothing except whatever is on Netflix Prime.
Jesus.
I'm a vegetable at night, and that's usually what I'm consuming. I have been listening to several messages, sermons from the Village Church, Matt Chandler. He did something in October, November, that it was like a 6-to-8-part series, and it's good. It just...
What was it about?
It's about God.
I mean, like... being good and stuff.
Really? Sounds compelling, Jeff.
Yeah.
You had me at God.
No, the
you should be a better husband.
Yeah.
And a better father and the, your son.
Stop sinning.
Yeah. The stop idea the of like what Jesus actually means, what living a life of Jesus actually means. And
okay.
You don't have to go out and you don't have to go out and do all these things.
You don't have to be like Jesus. For you can salvation. Just be like Jesus.
It's like Jesus will transform you over a lifetime if you'll go after it. And that's what it's about.
Is that what it's about?
It's one of the things Andy...
I just want you to know I bit my tongue. Good grief.
Andy's just shitting on your point, Jeff. I'm with you.
I'm with you too, Jeff. I'm just having fun.
Got any cake?
Stop making a shit cake.
Hey, man. We should have donuts.
Stop sinning.
Donuts and cake.
It's buttholes and butts. Oh, gosh. All right, here's what I've been consuming.
Cakes and pies.
I gave a little hint about it last week, but man, Stephen Wilson Jr., his album is called Son of Dad, and it is so damn good.
There's like... I'm trying to hit the post. He's got such a country voice.
Oh, just wait for it.
Cemetery kids on a midnight clear, saying Bloody Mary in the bathroom mirror.
I hope so.
Sneaking natty lights down the stairs of the basement. Ain't much to do, but the night's what you make it. Running down a dream on Stephen King and Kerouac.
What struck me about this?
Pink house, pink Cadillac. It's not just any patch of pitch.
I like it. I want to listen to all the lyrics.
He's super thoughtful.
He's more country than I usually listen to, but as soon as he opens his mouth, I'm like,
you believe it.
I believe it.
You believe it, right?
And it's authentic and it's real. And some of the songs are like, it transcends country. Some of them are very country. Did he? One of his songs is on Yellowstone, I think.
Oh, is it really?
I think. I want to say Cuckoo is on Yellowstone, but I don't know.
You could be right.
It sounds like it.
Is the woman that's singing,
She's somebody. She's Haley Witters. She's a somebody.
Somebody that just
my daughter
joined
knew her.
In to do this.
Yeah.
Okay.
She just got added in for this song.
That sounds really,
dude,
amazing. It's amazing.
So the song that really caught me was this one. And he wrote this song, or wrote this album about losing his father suddenly in 2018. And I feel like this song, he could have named the whole album, but the album is called Son of Dad.
Life is a battlefield, and it'll drag you right through hell. Bites like a rattlesnake, the kind that you just don't see on the trail. I miss my father.
I feel like I'm getting his private journal.
I know.
The kind of pain
in every song.
I pray don't fade away.
This line.
And the ones above guide me down the road. Yeah, grief is only love that's got no place to go. From my great granddad in the ground to all the ghosts in my hometown. Yeah, they're the ones that find me down the road. Yeah, grief is only
Yeah, that's a mind melter.
Yeah,
like
when I first heard that, it was a mind melter. I physically didn't know how to deal with that line there, because it had struck at such a deep truth of that feels like it just transcends. I don't care what you believe. That's true. That statement that, and it struck me as odd. As like, how is no one ever said that before? I mean, maybe they have, and I just didn't stumble across it, but I had never heard anyone else put it that way.
It's so simple, and it's so brilliant.
And it's not just one relationship. It could be across everything.
Because grief has so many shapes and so many causes, right?
Yeah.
And I found myself, like, pressure testing that in different parts of my life. And it was like, it kept coming up true. It just kept coming up true. That, yes, that's what it is. Grief was this hope. Grief was this expectation. And so at the bottom of it was grief was a love, an attraction to goodness that didn't find a home.
Right, or it's brought about because what you thought was home is now being shifted, and so like you're losing something that you loved and maybe appropriately loved, but then it's just gonna have to learn to move to a different spot.
Yeah,
I know people would see whatever they want to see in it, and I see Jesus in it.
Yeah.
And there's a very deep seated message in there, but it's only if you receiving the song actually see it as Jesus, the Spirit, just like take this, like he's singing this. This came from somewhere that many songwriters and musicians just can't get to. Because right. I remember you brought that. You're like, listen to this. This is amazing. I'm like, oh, 5 seconds just went by, and I'm like, I'm already jolted in my soul listening to it.
And we don't encounter that very often.
Nope.
Right?
How can we encounter that more?
Well, it takes someone that's believable. Like we said earlier, like, I feel... You have to believe the person that's singing it.
But there's something that they give off where they completely, utterly believe what they're saying because either they've lived it, they know it, they felt it.
Yeah.
It's real.
You can't fake it. I think what you're saying is like, there's no faking something like that. And we all sniff that out. We sniff it out when someone's faking it.
Yeah, I never understood that. And maybe there's great truth to that. You two are musicians, so you would know better than me. But just... The that movie, I can believe
the one with Bradley Cooper and Lady Gaga.
No.
I like that movie.
It wasn't bad.
That was good.
I can believe
Star is Born.
No.
Oh, the Matt Bombs movie.
No,
I can only imagine.
I can only imagine where there's a moment where like I don't believe you, like you're just like spitting words out, and it's like Christianese, but it's. Don't. It's nothing until it's what you are. Like who? Like there's no. Your heart's not in it. Like this isn't. You're telling some story that's just a BS story that anybody could tell. Tell your story, type of thing. And that. This feels like it. Just something great to it,
dude. That song that I'm playing right now is called "Twisted," and that chorus is "God is good." And life is twisted. And that's where, like, he holds those things in tension, which is feels like the most honest and real thing that we all experience as humans, right?
Yeah.
Like, how do we recognize that God is good and life is twisted?
Like, this is country music, but it's also, this is in the church.
It should be. It's more church than a lot of churches.
Oh.
Just imagine if we just had Mark's version of the crucifixion. It's so dark. Like at the end of Mark, they pin a bow on it, and there'll be a little footnote where it says like, yeah, this wasn't in our earliest documents. This was added later. But Jesus is just like, Jesus is a version of this where it's like, why have you forsaken me? And we marry these gospel narratives to like, yeah, but Jesus also knew what he was doing. He knew his purpose. Not in Mark. Jesus knew his purpose, and then God abandoned him. And that's just, just imagine, like, you feel abandoned by your creator. Like, what? Like, if those words are real, I know we can interpret them in a lot of different ways. Why?
How like Jesus are we supposed to be?
I know. Sometimes we die.
Well,
there's a lot of pain in that.
There's some healing and processing with me with this album.
That's good.
As I, like, listen to this, and while I've not gone through the loss that he's gone through, I experience a world that's not okay, and I experience my own, like, I walk through my own experience that's not okay, and there's some solace there, and some of the solace is, like, not solving the problem, but just recognizing that it's not everything is okay. Like, I keep thinking back to the time that David Bazan came and did a house show at our place. David Bazan, a Pedro Lion, and someone asked him, and they're like, "Hey, so, like, why do you write so many songs about, like, dark stuff?" And he said, "Well, because stuff is dark." He's like, his point was, well, like, there, that exists in the world. And so I choose to recognize those things, and I will write and sing about those things.
Yeah.
Because they're there.
Yeah. And some people, we all know people that are just, no matter what's going on in their life, they are a beacon of light and hope and joy constantly. And that's a muscle that's inspiring to me, because I don't have that often. Like, even in my good times, I'm still like, I want to be like, no, it's good, but
Ohtani might go to the Dodgers.
And it turns out you knew it would happen.
Yeah. And enjoy that second half of the contract. That's going to be rough, but enjoy the first 5 years. It's going to be great.
He backloaded all of his money.
Yeah. But thanks for that, Andy. Man, thanks for watching. I don't know. We got to land this thing.
We're still trying to figure out YouTube, how to do YouTube. So we appreciate you listening. We appreciate you watching.
Where do I put my hands?
Feel free to, subscribe, rate, review, wherever it's appropriate. It's different on every platform. And then,
you know how to do the things.
You know how to do the things.
You're all adults.
Honestly, we care, but
we care.
We don't care.
No. Don't listen to Jeff. He doesn't know what he's talking about. We care.
We do care because...
We do. But we care for those people who actually
care. Andy and I care more than Jeff, but we care.
Jeff shows up and he drinks our booze. But we love him deeply.
There was truth to that.
Jeff shows up, drinks our booze, and then I give Andy and Jeff a gift. Then Andy gives me a gift, and then Jeff takes the gift that Andy gave me as well. So that's...
I gave you half a gift. I gave you a gift that I asked you to return later.
I'm getting so fat in life with everything, material things, and so selfish.
It's so good to be
just
Jeff.
Kicked into the Irish man.
Yeah. All right. Well,
okay. So on. So
I need to take your potatoes too.
At Bros Bibles Beer on all the socials, and please email us brosbiblesbeer@gmail.com. We love those. And obviously, clearly, we read them. And Jeff just broke his microphone.
Hey, guys.
He caught it.
That's amazing. Good job. That was a catch.
Yeah, we're back to inbox zero. So hit us up. And then, we'll see you next. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. All that stuff. We might record one more before the holiday season.
Let's sneak one more in. I think we can do it. Let's
sneak it in before 2024.
Yeah.
Maybe it would be a special Christmas episode, and one of us would do a little bit of research.
We'll move from Jordan to Kobe.
Oh, too soon.
Okay.
All right.
I like basketball players that can fly their own helicopters.
Hey. For Jeff, Zach, I'm Andy. This is Bros, Bibles, and Beer. Grace,
peace.
Cheers.
Good night.
Cheers. No. Clinkies. Yeah, there we go. Beep, 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 beep.